10:31. So welcome everyone to this session on Flask and MongoDB. Before I introduce the speaker, a little bit about Devopedia. Devopedia was started about 4.5 years back. It is mainly meant as a platform for developers to come together and collaboratively publish articles which are useful, articles on technology. So partly it was inspired by Wikipedia, where we like the collaborative approach of Wikipedia. So anybody can get into the system and add or edit content. So we have adopted more or less a similar process of collaboration in Devopedia, except in devopedia.org, we publish only technical articles. So those of you who are new to this platform, you can get online, go to devopedia.org, and there you will see a lot of published articles. And once you're comfortable, you can also become an author. Just create an account and start writing on any particular topic which is not yet covered. Then it will go through a couple of reviews. If you're a new author, it will go through a few reviews. And then once it reaches a certain quality, the article gets published. So mainly the idea is to simplify technology, not just for developers, but also for non-developers or non-programmers, so that they can understand technology from simple terms, good explanations, use of images. So that is how we try to simplify technology for developers as well as non-developers. Beyond the platform, we are also doing this kind of online tech talks, which we started last month. Before that, before COVID, we used to do classroom workshops. And because of COVID, we haven't been able to do those kind of workshops anymore. So we thought, let's at least do online tech talks. So we started it last month. And typically, at the end of the talk, the recording will be available on YouTube. So that is the introduction of Devopedia. Now I will introduce the speaker and then we'll move on to the topic. So today's talk is from Shruti Sagar, who works as a software engineer in Du Telecom in Dubai. Before joining this particular company, he was working in various roles as web developer, web designer, software engineer, mainly in tech companies in Bangalore. Before starting his career, he graduated from Jyoti Institute of Technology, I believe it is in Bangalore, and then he got his master's from BITS Pilani. Although today's talk is about Flask and MongoDB, Shruti Sagar is experienced in various other technologies, including Django. He has done a lot of development in Django. And in fact, in his current role, he does a lot of React programming as well. Essentially, he's a full stack developer, and it's my pleasure to invite him and welcome him to this talk. Shruti, over to you.
Thank you, Arvind. Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. So today's talk is more about Flask and MongoDB. Before we begin with that, we'll start with what is a web? Is it audible? Inaudible?
Yes, I can hear you. Yes. Okay.
So what happens in a web? The browser. First, the user who sits on a browser, who uses a browser, sends a request to the server, which has all the headers, like it might be authorization or any other headers the application wants. It sends to the server. The server does fetches the requests and does the task based on the request provided, like probably getting some data or inserting some data, something like that. And then it returns a response with the headers and the content. This content which is returned can be viewed by the user on the browser. So this is how a web basically works. Now, why would we need this? We have how is it possible? So we have something called HTTP protocol, and what it does is, it's a distributed hypermedia information system which allows the users to communicate on the World Wide Web. The application that we are building now is on this HTTP network or HTTP protocol. So it stays on the application on the TCP/IP model, or if you consider the OSI model, today's talk is mainly concerned on the application layer, but yes, it can go up to session layer on what we are doing. If you want to do it on a secure way, we start with we import all the use the sessions so that it goes on well. Now, how can we do this using HTTP? There are few methods called HTTP methods, and there are status codes. So HTTP methods are the ones that specifies the browser or specifies the server what to do. We have mainly get, post, put, delete, and there are few more other types, but these are the main methods that we are going to use in a common scenario. So the get request, as the name suggests, it says the network or it says the server to fetch the data from the database or the system. Or the post request sends some data which would be processed, would be saved, or it would be processed and returned with some response. Put is, as we have seen, as in the presentation, it's used to update the information on which is already in the server, while we use delete to delete. Suppose we have some record which is not necessary for us, we want it to be deleted, so we use the delete request, delete method in the HTTP. Now, what are these status codes? When we do something, we should know what would be the response. Like what the browser has to understand what is the status of the request that it has sent. So there are mainly five types, hundreds, which starts from 100 series and 200, 300, 400, 500. Each of them, each 100 specific are series are of specific types. Like 100 series is for information. Examples in 100 series is the status code 100 is returned when server has received the request and waiting for the further instructions from the client. Similarly, 200 series, this is the most common one that we would be using. 200 is used, 200 is a generic request which says okay. So any request which has no status code sent from the server, it would be, or status code programmed, it will always be 200. So, and then 201 comes, which says created. So suppose you want to post some data into the system, then you give 201 as a status code saying that data has been stored successfully. And 301 is for redirections and other purpose. Suppose you move your site to some other URL, or maybe a specific document is moved to a separate URL. For that, we use 300 series. While 301 is for it's permanently moved and so on. We have other things like temporarily moved, or this document no more exists, all that we would have in 300 series. While 400, it says there is some client error, that is, there is some issue in the browser because of which the server is not going to process your request. You might have seen 404, and you might be very familiar with that, which says 404, the document the user is requesting is not available, is not found. While we have 401, which says you are not authorized, 403 says forbidden, and each of them are specific. And suppose you might have a doubt, there is a get request. What we are using a get request, what if I do post on it? So for that, to handle that issue, we have 405, which says the HTTP method is not allowed. And then we have 500 series of errors, while as we have seen, 200 is a generic code to say it is okay. Similarly, 500 is a generic error, says there is some issue in the server which is not specific. So we are not, the data is not getting, your request is not getting processed. While 501 says that it might not be implemented, or 502 says you are using a bad gateway, or 503 says the service is unavailable, probably the service is temporarily down. This was one of the response that we were getting in the Facebook down that had happened a few days ago. Then, so with this basic introduction on HTTP, we'll then move on to SQL and NoSQL differences. You might be familiar with SQL and NoSQL. SQL. So SQL is used for relational database management, while NoSQL is non-relational. So that means there is some data which might not be related. Like in SQL, we'll see how the difference between SQL and NoSQL at the implementation layer in the next slide. While there are many types in SQL, we know that there is MySQL, Microsoft SQL, Postgres, and SQLite, and there are many other. These are the most common ones. While in NoSQL is a different types. So you have key value pair, which looks like a JSON, or if you consider it, it looks like a dictionary. The example of key value pair database would be Redis, and we have something called wide column, which is the most commonly used wide column database is Cassandra. And then the today's implementation part, Mongo, which is a document oriented database. And then we have something called Graph. So suppose example, when you consider LinkedIn, you want to see how is you will see there, this is your second connection, or this is your third round of connection. So that's a graph. So for such things, we can use, or if you consider school or college, the hierarchy manager to your lower people, like the ones after the manager comes, like who is the manager of this person. For all this, GraphDB would be best suited. For that, we have some example called Neo4j, which uses that. Now, MongoDB. Now, what is MongoDB? MongoDB is a high performance document-oriented database. So that means the data would be stored as documents. It would be in a BSON, not JSON, BSON. That is the MongoDB specific for JSON type, where it has few more additional properties, like it uses some generic ID and all. And then it is of very high performance because of it uses the indexes are managed very well. And then it has a very good the replication and failover management has been developed very well, so that the system is always available for you, the system doesn't go down. And the scalability, the difference between NoSQL in Mongo and SQL is the way it is scaled. The scalability in Mongo uses auto sharding, while it's a different in SQL. And then, yes, this is the slide that I was telling. So if you consider RDBMS, it uses the database, which is the common. Now you have tables. You say user table, and then the classes table, student table. While here it uses collections. The name is called collections, while the rows is called documents. So each document is specific to one record. And then you have columns. So rows, suppose example of rows and documents is, let's say you are storing data of one student, his name, his age, his class, all that would be part of one single document for one student. And columns is called fields here. So all the fields that I told earlier, like the name, class, all these are called as fields. This is a very basic introduction on MongoDB. And then we'll now see a small, we'll understand what Flask is now. So Flask was developed by Armin Ronacher. So he did it, and it's a WSGI based API server. So there are many other servers like GUnicorn, for again which on which Fast API, another data, another emerging API technology which is coming up, and then it uses Rigzag as WSGI utility library. That is the server, and it is Jinja based. So Jinja 2 is a templating engine where the UI can be done, and it's more explicit than Django because it's very much easier to learn, because it's very simple. You can just run your Flask app in minimal of 10 lines of code, and it's very lightweight because it has nothing other than the server. If you want anything on it, you can start importing it and using it. And it has you can modularize it very well. It can be modularized very well, and it has very good thread management and protocol management system. For the people who know Django, the difference between Django and Flask is like this. So in Django is, as you know, Django comes up with everything. It has ORM, that is object relational mapping, templates, admin console. Everything is built in Django, but in Flask you might not need a ORM, so you have to install if you need. So it's very light, making it very lightweight. And Django, because it has everything inbuilt, it needs more of practice to learn it, while Flask is not like that. You want something, import it, use it. You don't want it, you don't have to worry. So you have, as I've said, it has everything. And bootstrapping tool is what we have said. Like, it has Django has every caching, everything is by default available in Django, but in Flask, you want it, you got to import it. Now we'll start with the implementation part. So we'll start with a simple application. Yes, this is a simple application. See, this is all Flask is. If you do this much, your Flask application is ready. Now, so we'll see how to run this. So I'm activating my Python environment, and then I'll use Python app.py. This is the first example that we are going to see. Our server is ready. Now we'll see what all do we have. We have two requests here, right? So one is a simple, methods. You can see here, right? I'm specifying the methods that I want. While here, I have not specified anything. If I have not specified anything, it is by default understood as get request. Now we will see how to implement this in Postman. So first we will see the get request that we have used. We have got our response. See, in this I have not specified anything, so it says 200, okay. In the next example, on the main application that we are building, we will see how the status codes are implemented. Now we have understood what is a get request. Now let's see what post request is. So I am posting some data. So if you see here, I have an event called introduction. So this is the data I'm posting, and let's see what we have done in this. So I'm just returning the request.json. I'm doing nothing other than that. I'm just getting the data and returning it back to the server. This is just to understand how POST works. So if I do this, whatever I've sent, I've received it back. So this is how a simple GET request and POST request looks like. Now, with this small introduction to Flask, we'll see what Mongo is, and then we'll come back to Flask with implementing Python, with its implementation in our Mongo's implementation on Python. Let me open up a terminal. I've installed Mongo, and I'll go into this. So this is how my Mongo shell looks like. So we'll see what all the databases available. So we have these many databases. I've created just this one for learning. So we'll use learning. Now we have to see what all collections are there. So I have these many collections. We will see each of it. We'll first go into users. So the in SQL you use select star from users, right? While in this we use db dot. Because if you see DB, it is the database. So I'm using that DB dot. Now I have to specify which collection I want. Users dot find. So this is how it is. The next one we will see. I have only one. Now let's see how it comes up when there are many. DB dot brands dot find. So it gives me these many records. Now let's say I want to get only this one, right? So in SQL we use select star from branch where id equals one, while here we pass it as a JSON, id is one. Now in SQL, rather than star, we specify select name from table. So we can use that as well here. That is, we call it as projection here. Let's say brand name. I just want the brand name. I have to specify if I want it or not. So if I want, I have to specify as one. Now this underscore ID, I'm getting it by default at any point of time. So what is that underscore ID? Underscore ID is an object ID, which is generated based on a few parameters like your time zone and your computer address. That's the MAC address. Based on all of that, your underscore ID is generated every time a document is inserted. You can either generate a object ID and you suppose that is how insertion works. But now if I don't want underscore ID to be specified, I can just say underscore ID is zero, right? So this is how this works. Now let's see how insert is to be done. Insert into users. This is how we do in SQL, while in Mongo db dot users dot insert we specify it in our JSON. So we have, we'll see what the schema, what users contain, what fields does users contain first. So it contains name and email. So db.users.insert. Name is, we have got this. Now we will see db.users.find. Yes, we have got the second one inserted. Now see, an underscore ID is generated by default. Now I say, and the advantage of underscore ID is it's always indexed. So just the way ID is indexed, underscore ID is the default. While in SQL you might not use ID, you might use any other convention that you want, but in this, underscore ID always gets generated. So db.users.insert I will specify my underscore ID as 1, and maybe I'll say name test. I'll add few more details like phone. I'm not specifying email here. Let's see if it really gets inserted. Yes, it got inserted. But in the case of SQL, you would have to specify what all fields are mandatory. Here, it's no SQL. There is no schema. Mongo is a schema-less database. But the latest features that it has added, that if you want to specify schema, yes, well and good, you can do that. But again, it has few negative things, like few problems in that, which would be resolved in SQL. So if your database is highly relational, or there is something like you mandatorily need all this data, you have to use SQL. Or if you want all this at your application layer, you can handle it. You can do it either by handling in the application layer, like once the request JSON comes, you check if all of this exists. We'll see that also while you inserting one user going further. So this is how it is. Now we will see db.users.find, and I want where ID is 1. Like underscore ID, underscore ID is 1. See, the object ID is overridden, so there is no object ID now. But yeah, the advantages of using the Mongo's object ID is you can get the time it was inserted, and there are commands for that. Using just the object ID, you can get the time when the data was inserted, so you don't have to specify one more created time field if you really want to. So this is one of the advantage. Now, Mongo has a very good UI module called Compass, which is used for joining the table, which is very well used for joining the tables. Let's see a bit of that. Yes, this is called MongoDB Compass. So it shows me all that I have. Now if I want brands, see, whatever we could see there is all seen here. And indexes, see, underscore ID is indexed by default. Now There is something called aggregations in Mongo, wherein you can you can group it, or you can there are a lot of properties in Mongo aggregations. We'll see a few. I'll show a few. So you have these many, where you can skip, limit, match, which you use most of it, most of the times, match. We have all this. Let's see a small example. I have done on variants. So first I'm grouping. So grouping is, I want to group my, this is the variant. Before that, we'll see what variants contain. DB dot find one. Now we have some ID here. So if you want to see what it contains, db dot products dot find. I specify my underscore ID here of the whatever I've copied there. So the product name is carbonated strawberry water. Now, so we will see how many variants contain this product ID. Right? So db dot variants dot, we have something called count, where we can get the count of all that we want. All the you can specify. If you don't specify anything, it says there are 1000. I want to specify my product ID here. It says it contains only one. Right. So now so I'm grouping like that. There might be a few variants which has multiple products. We'll see that going further. We have all this, like I am going to push, that is, I'm creating an array of the variants of one specific project object. This object ID is my products now, because I'm grouping in this, the tech saying about this, I have to specify what is my, on what basis I'm going to group. So I'm grouping by object ID, and then I want variants. Where I am pushing all the variants of one specific product into an array. And then lookup, I'm going to do a lookup. So what is lookup? It's basically joining the tables. As you see in SQL, I'm going to join the tables. So I'm specifying, I'm going to specify which table I'm joining. What is the local field? That is, in this, whatever I've received here, what is the field, and what is the field in the products table. Now, if I see this, my local field is underscore ID, because I've changed this variant ID, I've converted this product ID into an object ID, and I've pushed it here, and then so both would be my local field and foreign field would be underscore ID. And then I'm going to fetch them as products. So now I have got some product ID, which is, this is my product. The name is trade 16 in round BLK or whatever. So like that. Now, because it's an array, and we know product is always only one, I want to project the product out. So I'm specifying product name is, so now it's an array. We know that it's an array. I'm projecting it out here. And then I'm going to sort it. So I'm just showing an example of how it looks like. I'm going to skip limit. So this is how we can implement joining of tables, or all the SQL related, we use something called aggregations. And then I'm projecting only the things that I want. We'll see now, we'll whatever we have seen now, we'll implement in our Flask. So I'm going to close it, close everything, and I'll start from first. So now we have understood what Flask, how Flask can be done. Now, let me collapse all. Now, let's ignore app.py for now. Let's work on run.py. So run.py, I have only one API here, but I've said we have done, we'll be able to see how the whole thing can be implemented. Yes. So there is something called blueprint. That is like, it's like a folder structure, or you're going to modularize your application. So I will say I want this blueprint. Blueprint is basically modularizing your Flask. So I have something called product. So if I see here, products contain APIs and controllers. So APIs would be the endpoints like this. And controllers, yeah, let's see here. So what it does is, I'm only writing a view here. All the tasks related to this would be handled here separately. So now let's see what this is. If I go into controllers, I'll search for get product. Yes, I've got something here. Right. So this is my products pipeline, or we can say this is my products. The function related to products is done here. So that is where we have APIs. This is just one example of how we modularize the blueprint. You can do it probably in a different fashion if you wish to. This is a generic way that I have seen being done everywhere. I have separated out my Mongo functions in a separate file. So I have like inserting a document is done here. It does nothing, just inserts and returns the whatever has been inserted. All the Mongo related work tasks I have done here. And then product, we have all, like we have one for products, users, variants. We do have all of them. I've not written any invariants, but we have for products and users. We'll see what users contains, and then we'll move into the product. We'll move into the products part. Now, first one is, I have user blueprint. So this is how you define a blueprint. You specify URL prefix for it, and then what is the name of the blueprint, and again it contains the method. So how now? Okay, we understood this is how we write, but how would your Flask know? If you go to app.py, we have something called register blueprint. So I have registered user blueprint here into my application. Now, what is my app? App is my Flask module. So with this, now we will see how we get users in our Postman. I have this, get users. So my URL is just this. I'll send, I'll do a get request. 404 not found, it says. So there has to be some issue. We'll check that. Okay, I have to specify forward slash. Okay, we are running still run.py. app.py, we have to switch to run.py. So there are two different applications that I have built just to show how things would be like. So now if I go in here, I'll do this. I'll get all the users that have been inserted. I have inserted name, email. You can see there is no underscore ID here. This is because the function that I have written. So if I go into controller of users, see, I specified my projection is nothing. So I don't want anything to be projected. Now I want get user by email ID. I have here. So I'm specifying an email as this. Now I'll get all my user data. This is how. Now we have seen that, but how would we get we have get user by email. Now we have seen that we have to implement status codes. So let's remove this response from our status code. Is equal to, I want only this here, JSONify is a module in Python which converts your data into user or browser readable format. So I specify my response here, and then I just specify my status code. Now if I go into users this function, it says I am returning HTTP status of OK. So HTTP status, it contains all the status codes that we want. If you go here, you have all of this. It's all, it's an inbuilt module in Python. You can just pull it, use it here. So I'm just inserting this one. I'm fetching this and I'm passing it out. So now if I run, it says 200 OK. Now let's insert one user to understand what does OK is. Now I just change an email. I've not handled how email has to be controlled, because you may general email has to be unique. I've not handled in the application. So if I run this, it says 201 created. So I've changed the email address. Now it should return me if I pass the email address here. Yes, I've got the data for that specific email that I have passed. So this is how the users work on. Now go, that's how the get and the post. Now imagine let's pass get by product by ID. Yes, so this is how I have specified some product which I have prefetched. I want all the products. Again, it's a get request. I'll send, I'll get. This is the pipeline that we had built earlier, or the aggregation pipeline that I was telling earlier is this. So I have only 10 records here. We'll take this out and then see how it looks like. Yes, it contains 10 documents. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So it contains 10 documents, because if you go into the products, where is that? Yeah, we have products here. If you go into the product controller, we have this. Get products. Where is, yeah, I have specific, if I see, we have something called request arguments. Let's see what it is. I want skip limit. I have all of this. I'll just pass this one, or let's pass limit so that we will understand how it looks like. Params. So this is my query params I'm passing. Let's say I will pass limit as 2. Now it returns me only 2 documents. This is because of the pipeline that we have written. We have skip and limit. That's basically used for pagination. This is how this would look like. And then if I go into, we have one last one, one big pipeline that we have written. This is the pipeline. So we'll see how this works. So we'll have to see what this API is. So if I go into APIs of product, I have this. So this is products URL prefix with variants. So product variant I have here. I'll pull this out. I'll make an API call. So we'll see what this contains. So this contains, this is one. So for this allspice Jamaican product, we have these many variants. We have 200 grams. It's some random data. This is how we would be getting. If you see Flipkart, like you have select what type you want. Like probably this shirt size L, XL. So based on what you select, the prices also do change. So all these are handled here. And with this, I would like to explain small information about JSON encoder. So see, this is a very simple application. This can go as huge as probably hundreds or thousands of lines. So you can handle everything. We have something called before request. I'm doing print am before request every time. So if you see here, it prints I am before request. So what it does is actually it just gets me, probably you can use this for initializing for a few of your database parameters like session where you are using transactions, or you can handle all authorization, authentication could be handled here. We have similarly, we have after request, where if some error occurs, you got to tear down your request so that the data, there is no, the atomicity of the database is maintained, all that we can do. And the last one is JSON encoder. We will see what happens if I don't use this. Then you'll know what, why I am doing this, right? And you, any API, yes, see there is a 500 internal error. It says object of type object ID is not JSON serializable. JSON serializable. So that means the underscore ID that we are getting with this Mongo's object ID is not serializable by JSON. That is the browser cannot read it, or the user agent cannot read it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to uncomment it. Now the underscore ID would be easily read as converted to string. See, if it's an instance of object ID, I'm going to convert it into string of that object and then return it. So this is how, it's a very simple example of how well you can build on top of the basics. We have seen how blueprints work. We have seen how encoder works. So you can specify port if you want. So let's say port equals, I'm running on 5000, default port is 5000. I'll stop this. If I run now, it will be running on 9000 port. So if I have to do again, I have to change all the parameters of the, it will be the same. It will just be running on a different port. We have one URL there. Let's see what it is. It just returns hello world. This one, if you have seen, this is the hello world. So this is returning. So this is all about the basic introduction on Flask and Mongo. It's just like probably a page out of the lot it contains. You can read more about it. You can implement it all on it. So yeah, with this, we'll move on to the Q&A if there is any.
Yeah, this is Arvind here. Anyone has questions, please go ahead. I have let me start off, Shruti.
Yes.
So in the compass, you showed a pipeline, no?
Yes.
So from that, can I copy that pipeline and paste it into my code?
Yes, that's available. So it even specifies which language you want. We can do that as well.
Okay, so that's good.
Copy it. Or you can, we can even, let's say we want to import some pipeline. You can, we can do that also. We have import from text. We can do that also here.
Okay, good. Thank you.
I have a quick question. In indexes, it is by default indexing on ID fields.
Yes.
And there can be custom indexes as well, I suppose.
Yes, you can customize on it.
Yes. Is there an equivalent to RDBMS indexes? There are two types of indexes, right? Clustered index, non-clustered index. Any equivalent
yes.
here?
There are a lot, like you can specify unique index. You can all the, like it contains most of the features that SQL contains, but only the difference is there is no schema. The major difference is on an implementation level, there is no schema. So you can just insert anything. Yes, there are all kinds of indexes that you are talking about.
Okay, the indexing that is happening here is logical or physical?
I suppose it's a physical index because it's a document, it will be a physical one.
So if I am restructuring the index, it will physically restore the data.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Arvind, I Sanjay this side, I just have a request. Can you just share the link of YouTube channel so the participants can actually access the recording of this session at a later stage?
Sanjay, I think that will be done from Devopedia side.
Yeah,
this
yeah.
recording will be available in the Devopedia YouTube
yeah,
channel.
No, the link of the YouTube channel, if they can share in the chat box, maybe people can subscribe to that to access the recording at a later stage. Yeah.
Okay, I'll check that. Give me a moment.
Yeah, another way is people can find the channel by searching for Devopedia on YouTube. May I request Shruti to just open a tab and do this so that people get an idea. Since your screen is shared, it will be easier. Just take a browser tab and go to our YouTube channel.
Yes, this
one. Yeah, that's the one. Yeah. Any further questions?
Yeah, this is Shivraj here. Thanks, Shruti, for the very informative session. I have a couple of questions around portability. Now, if we have started this application in Flask, number one, is it possible that, if we are migrating to Django tomorrow, is it possible that we can use some of this code or is it like completely different?
You can use all this, it depends on how you structure your Flask application as well. But yes, you can use all of this and the way the Django is structured is completely different. But this, that's why I have modularized it in such a way that this can be completely reused. This part,
okay.
The controller part and can be completely reused. So this
okay.
can be
so
used, only the this one would be different for you. The API
okay.
part would be different.
Okay. So it all depends on how we structure the application, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Thanks. And the second question is, you mentioned that Django has its own ORM framework, whereas in Flask, it doesn't have one. So is there any other ORM framework which is recommended for Flask applications?
Yes, there is a huge community for which is developing Flask. So there are many ORMs. You can just use SQLite, Flask SQLite. See?
Okay.
You get all of it. So you have it here. We have. You can use just the SQLite, SQL Alchemy you have, which is again SQL Alchemy is the generic one. If you want specific to Flask, there is a Flask SQL and Alchemy, which has its own advantages and disadvantages on both. So there are there. SQL Alchemy is the most preferred one.
Okay. And last question is how easy.
In fact, SQL Alchemy, just complete that response. SQL Alchemy is a generic ORM, which I have used in Django.
Okay.
So, yeah. I mean, just because Flask doesn't come with ORM, it only means that it is not coming out of the box. Otherwise, you can install it and use it in your Flask project. So SQL Alchemy is one thing which will maybe ease the portability, because the same thing can be used in Django.
Okay. And last question, how easy is it to integrate front-end libraries like Angular, React, and so on in Flask application?
Yeah, you have something called templates. You can just build your Flask. So you have all these URL endpoints, right? So you can use this endpoint on your integration, and then the UI that you build, that is when you do npm run build, that build folder, you can put it as a template here, and that does the work. So there is something called templates, which is not inbuilt to Flask, it's inbuilt, but it's not mandatory that you have to use it. So you can just use that templates and run on it.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Any other questions from other folks?
If no questions, I'll share the tiny URL for the Devopedia YouTube if people wanted to take it.
Yeah, sure. You want to put it in the chat? I hope people can see the chat.
No, I'm sharing my screen.
Okay, good. Yeah.
And then.
Meanwhile, others, if you have questions, just.
You are able to see my screen, the tiny URL?
Yeah.
I just created this tiny URL if you want to subscribe to Devopedia channel.
Any further questions on Flask or MongoDB? Or the particular example which Shruti has shared.
Yeah, if I may ask one more question. So Shruti, you mentioned that Flask and Django, when you shared that slide about the comparison, right? So Django is meant for large applications. So what is that exact criteria to define it as large or small? Is it based on the number of features or function points, or on what basis would you actually classify it as a larger application which should be built in Django and not in Flask? Could you please give some guidelines?
Yeah, one, as you said, one would be mainly on the number of, like, what are the number of features that you are using. Let's say you want, I have three blueprints here. I've worked on it here in this application. Probably you have something large and you want the templates. Like you said, you want the Angular part also inbuilt, but if you use the Jinja part, or even Django comes with a template engine, if you want that default one, you can use that. So it's very very lightweight when you compare to Django. I've seen Django running probably around 64 GB server, while Flask I can probably put it on a 4 GB server for a huge deployment as well. So it all depends on the number of modules that you have, and then the functionalities that you want, and the audience that you want. Like, probably you have a huge audience, something like even Instagram uses Django, so that, like, that it's a huge audience. Django is a huge audience for the very huge, like, so probably a social media or any other. If it's only for a small organization, a small project, like specific to a company where there are not too many users or like that, yes, Django would be, Flask would be very well supporting for that. It does support for long, huge user base also, but it's not as good as Django is compared.
Okay. So if I can, add one more question to that, if I am going to deploy microservices, which is obviously going to run in containers, should I go with Flask-based microservices or Django-based microservices? What is your suggestion?
My suggestion would be go with Flask. A few days ago, I just read a blog on this, because Flask does not have all that you want. you can have only what you want. While as we have seen, Django has everything from ORM to it has even caching included. So if you don't want everything, you want something specific, you can go with Flask. And people have recommended Flask for container for microservice architecture.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yeah, it makes sense because in a particular microservice, you are going to only serve maybe a very small part of your application. So you don't want a lot of stuff, extra stuff in there. For example, right, there could be one microservice which is dealing only with authentication. So you don't want the other stuff coming in and crowding that particular microservice. So Flask, which you install on a needs basis, will make it lightweight for every microservice.
Right, right. Understood from that perspective, but I was just looking at from the angle of security and stability, whether Flask is recommended or Django is recommended for commercial or enterprise applications. So I believe Flask is the answer for that.
Yeah, it's a huge community and it's easy to learn. So there are a lot of plus points about Flask.
Right.
And both are open source. Both Django and Flask, they are equivalent in terms of how they are developed and maintained. So both are in the open source market and both are Python based. It's just that in Flask, you have to figure out what are the components you need and install them separately.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Whereas in Django, the installation is no-brainer because you just one install command, you'll get everything out of the box. But then a lot of things you may not use.
Right.
So that's the difference, yeah.
What about security, sir? I mean, compared to Django, I mean, between Django and Flask, which is more, which has got more features out of the box?
That Shruti can answer. My view is that Django will have something out of the box. Flask, even if it doesn't suit your requirements, you take another third-party open source, which is not released by the official Flask team. You take a third-party component and install it.
Okay.
So there will be a third-party component which has a good reputation in terms of security. I mean, I'm assuming that component, all it does is authentication.
Okay, just apart from authentication, like, you know, managing cross-site scripting or maybe, all those different kind of, OWASP recommended, threat factors, right? So
yeah,
I was just looking at
answer.
That.
Specific answer I don't have, yeah.
No, I'm also not sure of that, what you are exactly asking on. And like, I've not worked much on the security part of it.
Okay.
I have to also figure it out.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
I think a general comment on security is it really depends on a lot of other things, like what type of ORM you are using, what type of front end you are using. Because in security, as they say, you know, the link, the chain is only as strong as the weakest link. So you don't know whether the problem is going to be in the Angular framework or React framework or the kind of ORM you are using. So all parts of the chain have to be secure. So it all depends what kind of components you use.
Agreed.
Yeah.
So certain frameworks, like for example, if I can take the example of .NET, right? So .NET has inbuilt features to protect against cross-site scripting or maybe server-side request forgery and all these known threat factors what are defined by the OWASP. So that is what I was like looking at, but not an issue. I will just research this online. Thank you.
Any further questions before we log off? Okay, thanks everyone for joining this session. Thanks to Shruti for presenting a very useful introduction to both Flask as well as MongoDB. and the initial introduction about the basics, comparing SQL, NoSQL, HTTP status codes, that also set the stage nicely towards the actual demo with the code. So those of you who are new to this, I hope this will inspire you to take up or at least investigate what Flask is all about, what MongoDB is all about, and make the transition towards NoSQL and Flask-based applications.